allowing us the privilege to honor and worship and adore you this morning. And Father, we just pray that that's what we do in all the things that we see and say and do, that you will be honored and glorified because we are here. Thank you for loving us. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. One thing, I forgot to announce this real quick. Bathrooms, if you notice, there's chairs in front of the doors. If you go through that door, all the way to the other side, in the middle of the room, just to the bathroom, these bathrooms is another set of bathrooms, and we'll have to use those this week until we get that finished off, okay? So if you need a restroom, it's all the way through the other side.
So does anybody want any extra credit this morning? They can tell me this song we're about to sing, That Where I Am. In my Father's house, there's many, many rooms. If I go to prepare a place for you, where in the Bible is that? Anybody know?
Hi.
That would be actually, that's not exactly where it's came from. It's came from John 14, 1 through 6. This whole song is almost verbatim of what it's saying, and this is actually Jesus talking to us in my Father's house. So let's go ahead and stand, and we'll be prayer.
I'm
James 1. James 1 through 12. 2. Start with verse 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. The brother in humble circumstances ought to take pride in his high position, but the one who is rich should take pride in his low position, because he will pass away like a wildflower, for the sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossom falls and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich man will fade away even while he goes about his business. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him.
Every knee. See how great is our God, and all will see how great.
week after we celebrate Easter, it's just the week after we went over the stories, and I don't know about you, but the week before Easter, I read all that last week. I go through it and ponder the things that are there and are there. And, Jesus in the upper room, reclined around the table with his closest friends. And he has a desire to eat this meal with them. That hasn't changed. In all these years and all the things that have gone, Jesus still has a desire to eat this meal with you. And that's why each week we come to this time and we do this. We do it in remembrance of him, in remembrance of what took place that week. We do it in remembrance that he rose on Sunday. Death couldn't keep him down. And so we celebrate today our risen Savior. When we commune with him today, we get to take in him. His body, his blood, that cleanses us, that gives us energy and re-strengthens us to do those things that he has for us to do. So this morning, we come. We come with prepared minds and prepared hearts to meet him, to honor him, to worship him in this service that we call communion together. So as your minds are ready, as your hearts are prepared, just today, because we're kind of scattered, we're going to have you just come and receive when you're ready the communion. For the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for your Son, for his life that he lived, for the life that he gave, for the life that he now lives today as a risen Savior for us. And it gives us hope, and it gives us salvation, and it gives us forgiveness, and it gives us so many things in life that come from you. Father, we just thank you for that. And as we come now to take the loaf and the juice, we just pray that, Father, it means what it's supposed to mean to us today. As we remember that sacrifice made for us. Father, bless those who partake. Bless the elements themselves. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. with offering, we've got a plate here and then back corner to sing our offering song. Feel free to go there and drop your offerings if you have to, or drop it on your way out. I don't know if you've noticed, offerings go towards a lot of different things. And we have, I was going towards this week trying to figure out everything that we have going as a church. I mean, between the surgery center, the bathroom renovations, the prayer garden renovations that's going on out front, the different things that are going on. And I need to let you know on a couple of those items what's going on. The prayer garden renovation is being done by high school students that need community service hours. And so the Boy Scouts that meet here have about a dozen boys that need to get 20 hours each for their high school credits and stuff. And so they've taken on this project. And this is what their project is. Landscape at New Hope Christian. And so from this point on, they're going to maintain, fix, build, weed, do whatever it is. If you take 12 times 20, that's 240 hours they have to put in. And next year, they're going to have 11 more boys join high school and have them come on board and do some of that work. So they asked in a meeting I had with them Tuesday night if they could take on that perpetual care of our landscape. Now, I know Robin trims bushes, does a lot of that, and does a lot of things. Robin can still do that. She can still kind of oversee. Because they're going to need to know, hey, we have some weeds here, or we need to get this done there, or these plants are dead, here's some new ones, plant them, kind of thing. So like that. Because they're going to want that leadership. But, they were out here yesterday, 4.5 hours. It took 4.5 hours to dig the one side where the bushes were out. Not easy digging, not easy. They're prepping it, getting it prepared for what's next for the prayer garden out there. So, good designs. One of the men in Boy Scouts has a brother who does all the landscape design for the city of Chicago. And they took pictures of our area and measurements and sent it to him, and he's coming back with a blueprint. Okay, here's what you do. Here's how you do it. So it should be very nice looking once they get done with that project and stuff. So we're kind of anxious to see what they do and how they do it. It's going to take a little while with them coming on weekends to get work done, so give them some time to do that. But it'll be worth it. So all we have to do is buy a few plants here and there. Our offerings go towards that. Bathroom renovation, offerings go towards that. The reason we're doing those things is because it's so important when someone walks into the building the first time. When they pull up out front, instead of scraggly bushes and everything over, they're going to see a nice, maintained front facade and what's there and stuff. And we've got to put our best foot forward. I don't know if you noticed, but there's some empty chairs today. Offerings go towards that, go towards programs and different things to minister to people so that we can put them in seats, so they can learn like we're learning today. I mean, it takes finances to do those things, to bring people in, to do programs, to get them here. And we're gonna try and design a few programs coming up to give you opportunities to bring people to, introduce them to New Hope Christian Church, introduce them to Jesus, so that they can come to know him like we do. That's offerings. It goes towards all sorts of different things that you may not think about, but it's important things that need to be done so that we put our best foot forward for him. And so today we're going to give and have the opportunity to give. And as we sing the offering song, the plates, like I said, are either side. You can feel free to drop your offerings in or at the end of church, whichever you desire. But we'll get that done. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and pray. Father, we do thank you for how you sustain us. We thank you for how you take care of us, how you have provided so much for us, Father, through our livelihoods, through our talents, through our abilities, through others that come through here. Father, we just pray that you'll continue to bless all that are striving to put you first, put a good foot forward in you. And Father, we just pray that this morning those who give, Father, give joyfully, that you will be blessed because of our giving. Father, just now, bless the gift and the giver. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Told them,
I'll tear down the temple and build it again in 3 days. He wasn't talking about a building. When he said, I'm coming back, they should have got it. What we're going to talk about this week is 40 days. 40 days of Jesus amongst the living, living himself and showing himself and what's there. And we're going to talk about what the disciples did. You see, there's 10 really good areas in Scripture that tell us about his reappearance and what took place. I mean, he wanted to make sure people knew that he was what? Alive. And you guys, this is huge because nobody else has ever done it. They haven't done it. I mean, Sun Yung-Nun?
No.
Muhammad?
No.
Buddha?
No.
Joseph Smith?
No.
I mean, I can go through all the different religions and their leading people and what people are putting faith in, and none of them are alive today. And yet today we get to come together and celebrate a living Savior. And we know he's living. They've seen him. They've done it. How many of you have seen him? I know you have. Have you seen a child born?
No.
Have you seen someone that obviously should not be here, that are here? Was it you who came up this morning and said that? Who said that about my wreck? Who reminded me about my wreck?
Steve.
Was it Steve? Oh, Steve comes to me and he said, you know, I got to figure this out. He said, you had a wreck out here that you should not have survived. If I wasn't taken from this seat to this seat, if my center council didn't break and give way, and that transformer came down, I'm done. But I was moved from one seat to another seat. And he says, and then you had this heart thing. And they tell you, you shouldn't have lived through it. But you did. He says, you got to think God's not done with you yet. And that's true. I really believe he's not done with me yet. I have things I need to do, and he's kept me around to do those things. But then I stand here and I look out, and I see you. And Jeff, basically your heart blew up, right? How are you sitting here today? God. And we can go through different things that people have had, and some of you have had cancer, some of you have had a heart attack, some of you have had other illnesses, something like that, and yet you're still here. Why? God. Because there's a plan, and God had a plan for his disciples. And that plan was not hiding in an upper room. And that plan was not being afraid of what was next. But that plan that's being brought out these 40 days after Easter, after his resurrection, is part of the plan. And I might go as far as to say that those 40 days after the resurrection are the most important part of the Bible for us. Because it proves to us he's alive. It proves to us that he's got something for us to do. It proves to us that we're not done. Okay, I've been a Christian for 40 years, been there, done that, been in my time, next, up to you now. Right? Some people get that attitude where I put in my time. And I've taught children's church, or I did this, or I did that. No. We're not done until we're done. And done spelled D-E-A-D. Until we're either dead or meet him when he comes. That's when we're done. But up until then, we have something to do. And there's stories in here that tell us that. And when you read the stories and you see what's there after he's come back, you're going to find out these four things. The disciples saw him. They saw him for those 40 days. They saw and witnessed. They witnessed blind receiving sight, lame walking, leper touching healed, people being fed that were hungry, cast out demons and men, brought dead back to life like Lazarus, had eaten with sinners. He had met with prostitutes. He held their children. He's eaten in their homes of those people. He had laughed with them. He had changed their lives. They saw him. Question: how many of you have seen him? You're not sitting here today if you didn't see him. You're not sitting here today if you don't know him. You're somewhere else, but because you were introduced, because you've been introduced to him and know him now, and see, you see him act all the time. You see him do things in ways that only he can do, and you say, well, why is Jeff here? I have a father-in-law who had the same thing Jeff had and didn't make it. And all I can figure is, he was done with him, but he's not done with him. And God has things to do, and he had things for his disciples to do. And so he had to show them who he was. He had to come back to life. And I would love to be there, to have been there, when he ascended into heaven. Can you imagine a sight? Could you imagine what a day. What an exciting day. What a horrifying day. Because as I thought about it this week, I mean, what a day to see him go and do that, to see that, to be, then to realize, oh, he left it all up to me. He left it all up to you. I'm going to leave my spirit with you that will strengthen you, guide you, lead you, direct you, but it's now in your hands. Did you ever realize that? This is his church, but it's in our hands. And if it's in our hands, what are we doing? I mean, they like to say, this is building is just a building, we're the church. Okay? How strong and secure is your church? How is your church with Jesus? I took that question this week and had to rip apart and say, okay, my church, this is my temple for him to live in, for him to do, for him to inhabit and work through me. How well am I doing? I mean, for Becky, you're planted in Forest Mere Park, right? And you have a home there, and he's planted you there for a reason and purpose. That's what you got to think. I'm not here by mistake. I'm here because God needed me here in amongst these people for a reason. And when, if you ever sit down and talk to Becky, you'll find out that she, in my book, runs the park. She does. I mean, if you go in there, and I've been in there several times catching gators, and when I'm back catching a gator, I'll say, do you know Becky? Oh, yeah. There's nobody there that doesn't know her. And the influence that you get. Now, I can pick on any one of you. I can pick on any name and say, you know, you're where you are for a reason. Not only are you where you are, you're in the circumstances of your life for a reason. And all of our circumstances are different, just like the disciples. They weren't the same person. They were different people, different situations that were all together, For what reason? Jesus. What reason are we all together here today? Jesus. And the question that I asked you, what are you doing with Jesus? See, there's more of Him than you can take in. Do you believe that? Do you understand it? So if there's more of Him than I can take in, I've got to give some away so I can get some more. And if I'm not giving it away, I'm getting weighed down with too much. I have got to find a way to get Him to others. I try to find a way every Sunday to get Him to you in a different view or different form so that you could see or get that, man, Jesus needs you. So the disciples saw Him. You say here you've seen Him. You've seen Him at work. You see like, so you've seen Him. Okay? So then point two, they obeyed. Okay, now I'm going to go to meddling. I'm going to go to meddling on myself. Do I obey? Do I go ye therefore in all the world teaching, preaching, and baptizing? Do I share His love? Do I share who He is and what He is? He's more than love. I mean, He's discipline. He's righteousness. He's, go through the Bible. There's all these, I mean, I have a poster that has all these names and attributes of Jesus. Who He is and what He is. And you could read them. Am I that? See, because Paul said those words that you hear, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And if Christ is living in you, you can't make Him do what He would automatically do. So He's either in you or He's not. I got my little white box. Sang that song for you a while back. Remember a song? If I had a little white box, put my Jesus in, I'd take Him out and put Him back again. Because that's how we treat Him. When we need Him, we pull Him out and we use Him. But when we don't, I got Him right here when I need Him. I'm going to tell you what I've realized throughout my years of living and stuff like that. I got to throw the box away. Not with Him in it. Take Him out, let Him have it, and then throw the box away. I can't keep Him in a box. There's so much of Him that is there that needs to be in my life, because without Him, I am. Without Him, you are nothing. And we've come to a point to realize that in our lives, that we're nothing without Him. And so what can we do with Him? The sky's the limit. Scripture tells us I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do things I couldn't think of. I could stand in front of a room of people and preach. And if you knew me in high school and stuff like that, I couldn't. I mean, I took on a facade in high school. I really did. I joined choir. Do you know why I joined choir? Because there was like 70 other people in that room and nobody could hear me. And I could be a part of a group but yet do nothing. But Cynthia J. Prezant did not like that name in high school. She was the teacher, the director. She was, and she would be, but what did I hear? Came from this section right over here. And she'd say, Steve, sing those first two bars. Okay? Gary, sing the first two bars. Tracy, sing the first two bars. Couldn't do it. I was silent. And I'd do it and she'd say, little flat, pick that up a little bit. Okay, let's go again. And I'd go again. And, what did I hear? You know, and she would bug you and push you until you got it. And I thought I could hide in that class, and then she said, Tracy, one day she said, Tracy, I need you to stay after class. And she had a group called Madrigals. 10 singers. Each singing their own part. Tracy, I want you to be part of my Madrigal group. I want you to. I can't even get the notes right. She said, no. You're on. When you're on, you're on. And you're ready. You just need the confidence. And she said, meet me after school, and I want to show you how to get confidence. And I met her after school, and she took me to the auditorium, and they were getting ready to do the musical Jesus Christ Superstar. And our high school was well known all over the place, because when we did a musical, it ran Friday, Saturday, Sunday for 5, 6, 7, 8 weeks. Every program was sold out. 3,500 people in that auditorium glued to a stage. And she said, you see this? I think you need this role. And she handed me a script, and she said, here. And it said, leper. Okay. She said, and there's going to be 12 of you on stage in this scene when the lepers come out. She basically made me an extra so that I could be in front of 3,500 people every weekend and get this confidence built up, and I can do this. And very smart lady who put us there, and I became head leper. Something that people would ascribe to. I'm that head leper. The head leper means that I was on stage and I had to crawl up the back slant and come out on top of a platform that was 24 steps high. And I had to writhe and ooze down those 24 steps to get on the main stage and be pulling at the cloth of Jesus. Other people just had to crawl across the stage and stuff. No, I had to go. And she said, you can do this. And we had special practices. And it would be just me on stage and the steps so that it would look like it's just floating blob of humanity down these steps. So I did that. She said, what do you think? I said, yeah, I can do that. Well, good. Our next musical is Sound of Music. And I want you to be Max Detweiler. You want me to be what? Yeah, and you only have 3 solos. I couldn't even say the word. And they put me in this. And it was her, through her persistence, that got me to a point that I could get up in front of people. And then I got up in front of people at church. I was in 10th grade when I did my first sermon. Minister there helped me put it together and stuff. And to make sure that it was good, he sent me to Lincoln Christian College to a talent rally. And I had to preach my sermon in front of this room full of people, that 50 other boys were preaching their sermons, and he said, let's see if you can win. I put together the sermon. The sermon had to be 12 to 15 minutes. We did it. I did it at church. 12 minutes, 38 seconds. I'm in. Get down to Lincoln Christian College. Everyone's there. I get up. I did my sermon. 8 minutes, 11 seconds. They said I sounded like a machine gun rattling off. Just everything that I had as quick as I could. And there's this little clock on the thing, and I looked down, and it was 8 minutes. And I thought, my sermon today. And I started off, and I redid the whole sermon in under 6 minutes. So my total time was 14 minutes and 41 seconds. The judge's comments were, nice try, excellent effort, but they knew I did it twice. You know, and so it was just one of those things, but it was a learning experience, and it wasn't because of the minister pushing us up, it was because when I was in eighth grade, Cynthia J. Prezondo put me in a musical. Unheard of. Only high school kids were in musicals, but here I was in eighth grade in that musical. And I was in musicals all the years through high school. Three musicals a year. Every year, through different things. So Wizard of Oz, I mean, I posted on Facebook a while back a picture of me as the Scarecrow in Wizard of Oz and stuff, and doing different things. I mean, all to get me to this, and I know this. I didn't know it then, but I know it now. To get me here. So that I could be an obedient Christian for Jesus. So that I would be over that horror of being, oh, I can't, to where I could stand here and tell you this story. And tell you how it's working out. I mean, so far, I mean, I am not the best preacher. By far. I watch some of my mind, I think, gosh, you know, if I could speak like that, or if I could... I think I'm speaking the way God wants me to speak. I think I'm getting the message to people that need the message. I just have a different style sometimes than others in different ways and means. I mean, gosh, I give Jesus out catching gators. I give Jesus out sitting in a fire meeting where things are going right. We have to say, whoa. You know, I don't know how many meetings you go to in public like that that they start off with prayer. We do in our house. You know, it's a part of what we do and what we are, and we ask God for guidance in what we do. I mean, it's important to me that we have that. And here, in obedience, the disciples. What's the hardest part about obedience, Gary, for you? Hardest part. The disciples found it. It was
disciples.
It says here, the hardest part of our obedience with the disciples was this word, waiting. How many of you like to wait? I mean, what is Jesus going to do next in your life? You just have to wait. How many of you like to wait? I mean. Okay, so I survived the wreck and I survived a heart attack. Four, am I doing it? Is there something else coming? Is there, you know, we wait on those things, but we wait. It says, many times you don't understand, but God wants us to wait so that we know it is Him. Wants us to wait so that we know it is Him. Well, if we came up with an idea, we just went and did it all the time and it all worked out. Who was doing it? We start thinking me. And He wants us thinking Him. In my time. And His time is not our time. And so we have to look it through and go through things. I mean, we'll get there in His time. So we have to wait. The disciples prayed. How do you pray about what God will have you do? I mean, every morning when I get up, my prayer is, okay, God, what's today? I know my plans. And I'll say it just as plain as that. God, I know my plans, but what are yours? I mean, I go into every day with a plan, with an idea of where I'm heading, and so often that doesn't work out. That changes. It changes with a phone call. It changes with someone asking. I mean, yesterday I had plans. I'm going to do this because I had Drew and Jeff out hunting and doing this, and I was able to go to Steve and help him out a little bit more and do stuff. Get back. Okay, I know I have to take a gator that we caught at 3 in the morning, that was hit my car, so he wasn't doing so well. I had to take him to the farm. After that, I was going to do these three things. And my phone rang. And Drew was on the phone, and Drew says, hey, I'm really not feeling well. Think I'm coming home. I said, yeah, come home. You know. So instead of these three things, he comes home, and I get in the truck with Jeff, and we have to go to Sanibel because they called and needed something out there. And we're going to do that. It changes in an instant. But nothing changes that I don't ask God. Or I don't allow God to have, I mean, I could be out hunting. If someone in the church calls and say, I got this, what do? I go do that. First love, church. First priority, church. It's the thing that we do. The other stuff is just on the side. But God has to be first. And the disciples got to this point where they had followed him for three and a half years. They were doing stuff. And all of a sudden he's dead and they're wondering what in the world's next. And he comes and knocks on the door and walks into the room. Hey! I mean, Peggy, not Peggy, but would you freak out if Norm walked in that door right now?
At least.
I mean, when we've lost someone and they're gone and all of a sudden they're there, you're thinking, you know, Mary and Martha, Lazarus was gone. Gone to the point that they said the word, surely he stinketh. And he walks out. Imagine. That is Jesus. And so we pray and we follow and we wait on him. We do it in a Honda. The Bible tells us that. It says the disciples were in one accord. Okay, it fell flat. You didn't get it. Anyways, they were together. When Jesus was walking amongst them for 40 days, you know what that did? That made the jello firm up. That brought them to the point that they're like, oh, he... You know, if you could see it in a cartoon, the light bulb went off the first floor. Now they got it. He said that he would, 3 days, and he's back alive. After he appeared to them for 40 days, what happened to the disciples? They were emboldened. They saw that we no longer serve someone who died. We serve a risen Savior. We serve one that says and does what he says he's going to do. And so, what do we have to fear? That's a big thing, because 40 days earlier, they were cowering in an upper room, afraid for their lives. And at the end of 40 days, where are they? Out preaching and street corners and just anybody and everybody they can see, they're telling. Hey, do you know about this Jesus? Do you know about... And what that tells us is that we should be the same way, shouldn't we? Shouldn't we be the same way? I mean, how many of you serve a dead Jesus? How many of you serve a risen Jesus? I mean, isn't that something to be excited about? Isn't that something to be emboldened about? That we don't serve one? And what can this world do to me? And if it does do it to me, if it martyrs me for him, win-win. I mean, people see it. They saw him die on the cross. And their hopes were this. That'll shut everybody up. That's what they thought. We get rid of the head, the rest dies out. They didn't plan on that head coming back to life. They did not plan on these people being emboldened and going out and changing the world. And literally, in in that time, that area, they changed the world. I mean, 3,000 came to Christ. Those are big numbers. I mean, we would be ecstatic if 3 came. We celebrate each and every one as they come. I mean, it's just that exciting. Can you imagine? I said this one time to a bunch of kids sitting in the room. I said, I would be so bored watching 3,000 people get baptized. Would you? And after I made that statement, I thought, well, wait, I get pretty excited when we dump 100. And can you imagine 3,000? I know how I get at church camp when we baptize 20 kids at one time. I mean, that is just like, and then I start thinking, thousand. And that was just men. That's all they counted them. It could have been women and children and families. I mean, how exciting would that be? I mean, if we took 3,000 people over here to the swimming pool and baptized them, we'd raise the water level, wouldn't we? I mean, you start thinking those things like that, it's like, oh my gosh. And so we look at it and we say, okay, they're united in what they're doing, and they're going to change the world because of it. Romans 14:19 says, therefore let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things that by which one may edify another. Let us look for those things. And this is the disciples looking, okay, how can we bring peace and yet edify others? There was turmoil in the land then. It was bad because of this Jesus. And they thought they were going to hush it up. And all they did was ramp it up. These disciples went haywire. What would New Hope Christian Church be if we went haywire? If we decided Jesus was the most important thing, he's the thing that everybody needs, and we've got to be the ones to tell them. How would it be?
Full.
Wouldn't it be amazing to see and be a part of, and just the atmosphere of electricity that would flow as we got so excited that, ooh, I get to bring one. Not only do I get to bring one, but I've worked with one, and I'm going to tell you this. There's nothing more exciting than this, that you bring someone to church and you work with them, and you teach them and show them Jesus in you, and they come here and they learn about Jesus, and they want to get baptized. Nothing more exciting than this. Gary, would you baptize me? You never had a feeling until you get that feeling that somebody asked you to usher them to Christ. I mean, just that it gives me tingles thinking about it and thinking about the ones that we baptized and did. I mean, it's that way. I mean, I have a link to everybody I baptized. I just feel like I'm connected then. That I mean, I have kids that I baptized 35 years ago. Still call me today. Hey, what about? I got kids that when I'm on trips, I'll stop and see and say, hey, you got to be about this. Because I feel linked to them that I have to be able to tell them, hey, you got to do this. You know, I got to remember yesterday the link with Kyle. Now, I don't know how many of you got to know Kyle. He's Stephen Ronda's boy, the big boy here. Man, Kyle is a neat person. Kyle is excitable. He sees things. I'm going to tell you about Kyle, okay? Kyle might be that big, those things, doctors told Stephen Rhonda, he'll never mature beyond 12 years old. And I'm going to tell you this, if you know Kyle, if you got to know Kyle, they were right. Yes, he's afraid of the dark. Yes, he will do anything for a friend. Anything. I mean, if he thinks you might be his friend, they bought him a little house over here, and he was living in it, and Steve would show up, and he would have three girls there that have little kids. Kyle, what are you doing? Oh, they're my friends. How are they your friends? Oh, they needed a place to stay. This guy, this girl here, her boyfriend was beating her. This one here is on drugs, and this one. So, Kyle, they're not your friends. They're eating all your food, they're taking all your stuff, they're taking your stuff and selling it. Kyle, where's your TV? Oh, they need it. Because they need it. And so he'd do those things. And Kyle is the neatest person. Kyle's going to be missed because he comes to Bible study on Wednesday nights and not afraid to ask a question. Hey, I was reading this, and what does this mean? And I guarantee you that when he asks a question, there's probably others of us sitting there that go, yeah, what does that mean? We're going to gloss it over and go on, but he asked a question, and we need that. We need the Kyles of the world, we need the Beckys of the world, we need the Garys of the world to be a part of. I mean, come to realize this, and this is what through this unity thing, the disciples came to realize, they needed each other. They needed Jesus in them to guide them and direct them and show them this Holy Spirit that he loved. They got it. They had to be unified in the power of Christ. That's what emboldened them. That's what put them on the steps of the temple. That's what got them telling people and showing people what it's all about. And I'm telling you all this because we need that power. We need that Jesus. We need that unity together that we said, okay, hey, we can do this. Can we fill every seat in this room? Absolutely. I mean, I could throw a concert in 2 weeks and put the right name out there, and we'll fill it. Will they be here the next week? No. We just saw that Easter. We could pack in some in it, and then afterwards it's like, we're not talking that. We're talking, can we fill the seats with people who are searching for the answer in life, and we know the answer is Jesus? Can we guide them to him? Can we teach them? Can we show them? Can we lead them ourselves to a saving grace in him? See, it's not about filling seats. It's about winning souls. It's about making a difference in this world, like the apostles were doing. And changing 3,000 people. I mean, if we are allowing God to lead, if we're doing his work his way, if we're living for him, it'll happen. It will work. We'll draw people to him that they see living in us. And then he wins. Not us. It's not about us. It's not us doing it. It's him through us. It's us giving up ourselves so that he can live, that he can touch and change life. I can't change a life. Okay, let me clarify that. I can change a life. But it won't be for the good. I can lead people. And I make a choice every day where I'm going to lead. I can lead him to Satan, or I can lead him to God. But only he changes him. And I've got to be about doing that. If you look at your life, and ask the question, what are you doing? What are you doing with Jesus? What are you doing with New Hope Christian Church? What are you doing to make a difference in this world? It only takes one to make a difference. I mean, just imagine if you were the one that recruited Billy Graham. Can you imagine? You were the one that introduced Mother Teresa. See, it only takes one. It takes us introducing to one that can change the world through him. So I want you to look at your life today. I want you to look at Jesus. I want you to look at, is he a part of you? Are you a part of him? Are you in him? Are you living the life for yourself? Are you living the life for him? Have you made a choice to give to him? See, I tell you all the time, the outfit I was wearing, I tell you all the time, I mean, it is etched in my brain the day I walked an aisle and accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I don't know if I'll ever forget it. I don't know if Alzheimer's could take it out of my head. It is that, in my head, it's like it happened yesterday. I mean, I see my great-grandfather standing at the front of the aisle with his camera. You know, the kind he looked out in, and he was like, click. And you waited 2 months to get the pictures back in the mail. You know? I remember the cookout at his house when he got his pictures back. And he held up the picture of me and my brother, sister, and my dad walking down the aisle. And he says with tears in his eyes, what a great day. What a great day that was. You know? Because it was life changing. He lived for that moment. To know that his life work, he was a church planner for the Southern Baptist movement, planted a lot of churches, and he saw in that group coming down the aisle the next generation to carry on. I mean, he could not have been prouder with that picture. And he said, well, you know, I fiddled with one. I didn't get any others. He was up front to take pictures of everything, get pictures all over. But he was so wrapped up in watching us get baptized, he forgot to click the camera. But he had that picture. And you could tell it was important to him because he had it blown up. And he had it in a frame on his mantle. And he's like, and every now and then he'd say, hey, Doc. Called everybody Doc. Hey, Doc. Remember that day? And normally when he said, hey, Doc, remember that day? We were doing something wrong. And it was his reminder to us that, hey, do you remember that day? Do you remember the day Jesus died on the cross for you? You remember? Do you remember them putting him in a tomb? Do you remember the day that he rose from the dead? Do you know and do you remember that you serve a risen Savior? That he's alive today and just as alive as he was when he was here? I mean, do you realize that? What do you do with it? That's what he meant when he looked at the picture and said, do you remember that day? Do you remember the sacrifice made for you? And if so, what are you doing with it? What difference has it made? So we're going to stand and sing a hymn of invitation. It's your opportunity to look at your life and say, did it really make a difference, or do I need a more difference made in my life? Any difference? Maybe you're here for the first time and you need to accept the Lord and Savior. We're going to talk to you about that. Moreover, you're probably here like me, and I mean, I had this sermon this week. I had to tear it apart and look at it in the garage. Look at it. Do you know Jesus? Have you seen him? Have you prayed with him? Have you been unified with him? Do you have his power, and are you using that power to change the world? It's all up to you. Decide as we stand and sing. Help us to shine you in all that we do. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.